Good morning, and thank you, Karen, for that wonderful prelude. I don't know about you, but that helps get the blood flowing and a great way to start our worship service together. I'd like to call your attention to a few things in announcements. First of all, statements were mailed out this week, and you may have already received yours if you're in the local area. If you're up north, it might take a few days more, but you will be getting your 2020 statements very shortly. Second thing I would like to call your attention to is, if you have not yet responded with an option for your envelopes, because several people have called in and suggested that due to the pandemic, they still have plenty of 2020 envelopes, feel free to use those. The numbers will be the same in 2021 as they were in 2020. So if you would like to use old envelopes from last year, feel free to do so. If you'd like to have new envelopes that are repurposed for this year, we can do that. If you'd like to just use a regular envelope and put your number on a check, you can do that. Even if you don't put your number on, we can cross check it and find it. Or you may wish to choose online giving or giving through your bank as a check to the church from your bank. Any one of those five options is fine. And we just ask you to let us know which one you have chosen for yourself. That will help us. So please do that. Likewise, I'd like to call your attention to what I was sharing in yesterday's news and notes. And that is that beginning this Tuesday, we will be able to have between 6 and 10, 12, maybe 15 people, couples will count as one person, come to be a part of the choir rehearsal and recording session that we do every Tuesday at 2:30. Everybody who's there finds that sense of being together with other folks from our church very uplifting, and we'd like to invite as many people to share in that as we can. All you need to do is email the church office at office@ppcfl.org or call the church phone 722-3513, area code 941, of course, and ask to be put on the list. We will make a list in the first 15 we will have for this week. And then if there are any overages, they'll be the first in line for next week. We'll have opportunities for you to sit far enough away from other people that it will be safe. And we will be taking temperatures at the door and also we ask you to wear a mask. That's just a requirement. The second thing is this week on Thursday from 1 to 2, I will be glad to facilitate a group of anybody who would like, up to, again, about between 6 and 10 people, depending on whether it's individuals or couples, to come, and we'll each sit at a table in the narthex and just first few times have a chance to talk and talk about what it's been like these last 10 months and just a chance to see one another. This is how we're going to safely begin to reopen the church on a very safe level. And the third thing is beginning a week from this Thursday on the 11th, we'll have the thrift store open for an hour, and we're inviting people to perhaps find some folks in your neighborhood that would like to come and be at the thrift store. We'll be checking temperatures at the door. Masks will be an absolute requirement, no ifs, ands, or buts. Our thrift store folks will be masked and have shields, so they will be protected, and we will be making sure the surfaces around are as clean as possible. We ask you to only use a debit or credit card, and that will just keep things a little bit safer. So those are on the horizon. I would like you to know about that. They begin as soon as the day after tomorrow and go into the end of this week and next week. And as these things unfold, we'll see how we can add to them. Those are the announcements that I would like to share with you. And I would invite you to join with me in affirming our identity and faith in Christ through the prayer of Saint Francis. Would you join me either aloud or silently where you are? Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is error, truth. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying to ourselves that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Our opening hymn is Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Continue to look at being like Jesus, believing like Jesus. We're looking for these several Sundays at Jesus' belief in God. Last week we looked at his belief in God as the one who brings to life community. And today we're looking at his belief that God is personal. Our scripture lesson is a familiar one that's right in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew's Gospel in the 6th chapter. And it follows a series of teachings where Jesus is teaching the disciples how not to pray. Not to pray like the scribes and Pharisees who do it for show, or the Gentiles who use flowery words. And so the disciples ask, well, how should we pray? And that's where our scripture lesson begins today. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us into the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Obviously, those last two verses are not part of the Lord's Prayer, but they are incredibly important in understanding the Lord's Prayer. I was reminded this week as I was preparing for today of a story of a woman who came to church for the first time. And an usher realized she was a first-time guest. And so he went up to her and asked her where she would like to be seated. And she said, "Oh, I'd like to be seated up near the front." He said, "Well, there's certainly plenty of seats up there, but let me tell you, I've been here for quite a while. And really the best seats are in the back." And she said, "Well, why is that?" And he said, "Well, our pastor is a wonderful pastor. Sometimes he gets a little long-winded, and I hate to say it, sometimes he even gets a little boring. So that's why I recommend you sit in the back. If you're prone to nod off a little bit, it's a lot easier to do in here in the back. That's why these seats are so much in demand. But you're here early enough, and I can certainly find you a seat in the back." She said, no, I want to sit in the front." And he said, "Why in the world do you want to do that?" And she said, "Sir, do you know who I am?" And he said, "No, ma'am, I don't. I just met you." And she said, "Well, I'm the pastor's mother." And the usher looked up at her and said, "Ma'am, do you know who I am?" And she said, "No, I don't." And he said, "That's good." And he walked away and left her. That story always tickles my funny bone, but it also lifts up something important about God. God knows who we are. God knows who we are because God is a personal God. God is the God of the universe, but God is also the God of our hearts. And God not only is connected and interested in the dealings of the vastness of the universe, but also in the dealings of the inner workings of our own hearts. God is personal. God is not some distant, far off force. As I continue to read through the book that Duncan and Sherry Bellinger have shared with me about a young Muslim man, a devout Muslim man who is seeking Allah but finds Jesus instead, one of the things that strikes me is how in his Muslim faith, his understanding of God was a God who was far off, who was up on a pedestal to be prayed to and adored and worshiped, but not personal. The God Jesus Christ reveals to us is deeply personal. And we come to understand it in these words that perhaps are too familiar to us, too easy to recite, more challenging to hear. The Lord's Prayer. Actually, this prayer includes everything we need to know about prayer. And it begins with two words. Our Father, our, not my, not your, but our Father, our. That word our is a significant and important word. The word our connotates a sense of belonging, belonging to. The word my indicates something belongs to me. The word your indicates something belongs to you. But the word our indicates we belong to something or someone. That word is an incredibly important word. It connects us. It reinforces the sense of community, that we are together. Our, it's a word of belonging. The first word of prayer is an affirmation of our belonging. Belonging to who? To God, who is known as Father. Let me be clear. The word Father here is not intended to denote the masculinity of God or to set God apart as Father over against Mother. It's not to say that men are more important than women. It's not to do any of that. It's to indicate a deep and abiding personal relationship. In Aramaic, the word that Jesus uses is Abba, which translates roughly daddy. It's a word of intimacy, of connectedness, of deep and abiding trust. Those are the connotations that Father is meant to give to us, not maleness, but intimacy, connectedness, love, trust. When one uses the word daddy, it conveys all those things. It is not meant to exclude anyone, but include folks. Just like the word our is a word that's inclusive, my is exclusive. Your is exclusive, but our is inclusive. I always get a little bit nervous when people refer to the church as my church. It's never my church, whoever me might be. It's our church. We belong to it. It's inclusive, not exclusive. And so our and Father go together to lift up the sense of inclusiveness and intimacy and connectedness to God in a very deeply personal way. Jesus reiterates this just a little later in the Sermon on the Mount when he talks about God who understands the needs of that you have before you even think of them. The God who knows the numbers of hairs on your head, who lifts up the sparrow, who in Jewish culture was considered nearly worthless. Those who couldn't afford a proper offering at the temple were offered the opportunity to purchase sparrows, two for a pence, and a third would be thrown in because they were considered virtually worthless, and yet God knows them. That's the depth of God's personal connection to us. Even the least of us, even in our own hearts, the least of us, God is deeply personal. The prayer begins with those two words, our Father, inclusive, connected, trusting, intimate, words, not about masculinity over against femininity, not about male over against female, but at a far deeper level to indicate how God knows us in deeply personal ways that invite us to trust and to surrender. And then as the prayer continues, it lifts up two sets of three petitions. The first, indicate the glory of God. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The majesty and glory of God. And then come the personal petitions. Give us this day our daily bread. And that is the idea that God is personally aware of what our present needs are. God is a God of our present. And his personal connection to us is in our present moment. Give us this day our daily bread isn't just about food, it's about every need we have in the moment, every gift that God gives us throughout each day. I'm not a big Facebook user, but there are several people when they put something on Facebook, I like to check it out. And our good friend Bob Flesh is one of them because he often has pictures of glorious, wonderful sunsets over the Gulf of Mexico. And every time I see one of those pictures that Bob puts up, I'm reminded of how God blesses us every single day. And as the day is drawing to a close, that sunset is a reminder of just how much God is involved in our lives each and every day. And there are plenty of other ways we could illustrate that, but that is one of them. God meets our needs every day. We just need to become more and more aware of it. And I'm always thankful when I see those pictures that Bob posts because it's a reminder yet again of God's presence and God's gift to us every single day. The next petition, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, is a reminder that God is personally present for our past. Forgiveness is the gift that releases us from the past. It frees us from carrying burdens that we don't need to carry. Hurts, resentments, bitterness, and the like. God is personally connected to our past, inviting us to let go. And that letting go is a twofold movement. It involves not only letting go of our hurts, but letting go of the things we hold against others because of what they've done. And it's that gift of forgiveness that gives us freedom to embrace the present moment in all its richness and fullness and joy and peace and love. God is the one who personally opens up the present by freeing us from the past. I was reminded this week of another experience of a young brother and sister who had been estranged from their father. Something had been said somewhere along the lines, and as so often is the case, something small became something big with time. It festered from a small cut into a major infection of the spirit. And the brother and sister hadn't spoken to their dad for years. they held their grudges against him. And now they got word that he was dying, and something stirred in their hearts that maybe it wouldn't be too late for them to see him and try to mend the fences that had been built and break down the walls that had separated them and the pain that had marred all their lives. And so they went to the hospital to see him and went to the nurse's station and asked what room he was in. And the nurse looked up with a somber face and said, "I'm so sorry. Your father just passed away. But if you'd like, I'd be glad to take you into his room. I noticed a piece of paper folded over on his food tray, and I didn't think it was appropriate for me to read, but perhaps you might like to see it." And so she took the brother and sister into the father's room, and there he was laying, no longer there, but his body was. And they noticed the piece of paper that was lying folded on the tray. And they opened it up. And they saw the last words their father had ever written. They're these words: "I forgive you. I love you with all my heart." They never were the same after reading those words. Tears flowed, grief poured out, all the bitterness and resentment from years gone past was released. And they each bent over their father's body and gave him a kiss on the forehead. And each said, "I love you too, Dad." That's what forgiveness does. It releases us. And so God, who is personal, not only provides for our present moment, but also releases us from the past so we can embrace and enjoy the present. And God also leads us into the future. Deliver us from evil and lead us not into temptation. That's about the future. The God who is personal leads us into the future, protecting us, keeping us safe, offering us hope, giving us new life. You've heard me mention him times before. One of the preachers who I've read sermons of for years and listened to and had a chance to meet. We both graduated from the same seminary. Jim graduated in the first class, and I graduated 15 years later. Jim Moore is a great pastor and a great preacher. Has retired from St. Luke's United Methodist Church in Houston, Texas, and now lives up in the Dallas area. His father was killed in an automobile accident when Jim was a young boy, 10, 11, or 12. And he has limited memories of his dad, but the memories he has are special. And he shared this one that really got my attention. Jim was visiting his grandparents one day, and while he was there, a terrible storm broke out. There were heavy winds and lightning and rain, and it was too dangerous to go outside. So Jim was not able to walk home by himself. And his grandparents were not of the age where they could safely walk him home either. And so he was to stay with his grandparents. And in the midst of the storm, there was a knock on the door and a ringing of the doorbell. And his grandparents went to open it and let whoever was there in. And lo and behold, it was Jim's dad, his father. And he opened up his coat jacket and said, "Jim, come here, get under here. I'm here to take you home. We'll make it safely. Just stay right by me." That's the personal God who leads us into the future. What a great image of that God who takes us under his wing, who holds us close, and brings us home safely. The God Jesus believed in and invites us to believe in is deeply personal, intimately so, not as father, but as daddy, one who we can trust, who includes rather than excludes, who's ours, not that he belongs to us, but that we belong to him. And who meets us where we are today and freeing us from the past and leading us into the future. That is the personal God that Jesus Christ believed in, and we are called, being like Jesus, to believe in a personal God as well. May it be so for all of us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, so be it, and amen. I invite you to listen to our special music this day as we continue to worship together.
Amen.
Would you join me in the spirit of prayer? Almighty God, as we come before you, we are almost left without words for your majesty and grace and power so exceed our ability to comprehend what you have done and are doing and will doing is far more glorious than we can even imagine. And so we come to your throne with praise, with thanksgiving, that you hold us in the palm of your hand, that you know each one of us better than we know ourselves, that your love for us is infinitely greater than we can know. And so we come to you with praise and thanksgiving, and knowing in a way that we can trust you and entrust those who we love and care about to you and raise our deepest concerns to you. We entrust to you each and every person and family that's somehow touched by COVID-19. The heartache and the horror and the fear and all that goes with that. And we ask in the midst of that, that you will bring your gift of peace, and you will quiet every fearful heart. And you, in the way only you can do, will let those folks know you have them. And we ask the very same thing for every person and every family battling cancer, battling heart disease, battling all the different diseases and illnesses that are so prevalent in our society these days. Let each and every one know your peace and your presence. And be with all of our doctors and nurses and first responders and hospital staffs, everybody. Whether in a hospital or a nursing home or assisted living facility or a memory care center, everyone who is caring for others and putting their lives at risk, be with them. Strengthen them. Give them encouragement. Give them renewed energy. Wipe away their exhaustion, and in its place put renewed energy. And where there are ways we can support them through words of encouragement or actions, make us extensions of your presence and your touch. And we ask you to be with our leaders in the midst of of all the division and all the lack of trust and the allure of power. Liberate them, free them, cleanse them. Make each and every one a servant leader. We lift up these and all our prayers in the name and spirit of Jesus the Christ, and as his disciples, we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen. Our closing hymn is a familiar one, Just As I Am. I hope we all have a chance to hear it with new ears and new hearts. This to sound like nostalgia week, but as that last hymn was being played, I couldn't help but find myself thinking about a Billy Graham crusade in Cleveland, Ohio, back in 1993, I think. And our church sent about 25 people to be in the choir there. It ended up being about a 6,000 member choir, which is quite an experience to sing. And there were people who could sing and there were people who could not in the midst of that, but whatever came out of it was a beautiful, joyful sound. And I got to be with my friend Dick Bunnell as we sat in the bass section together and sang that hymn. And so as that was being sung, I couldn't help but find myself back in Cleveland Stadium singing with my friend. And what a special moment that was. As we close our worship service, I invite you to join with me in our benediction, which you know well, and which speaks to us in all moments. We go nowhere by accident. Wherever we go, God is sending us. Wherever we are, God has put us there. God has a purpose in our being there. Christ, who dwells within us, has something he wants to do through us where we are. I invite you to believe this and to go in the joy of God's power, the joy of God's grace, and the joy of God's love. So be it. Have a fantastic week. I look forward to seeing folks on Tuesday. There's a chance on Tuesday that Cindy and I might not be there. We'll be in Sarasota, but hopefully we'll be back for the recording session. But there are people there who will be able to fill in. And for those that can join us on Tuesday, that will be a very special time, and we look forward to it. And the same thing for Thursday. Have a blessed week, all. Bye.